You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome back to Health Science 100, Health and Lifestyles. I'm Robin Sinks. I'm your instructor for the course, and this is session 8 in our semester-long journey through what we need to know to stay healthy, what we need to do to be healthier. And last week, if you'll recall, we talked a lot about alcohol and tobacco use. We reviewed how alcohol is absorbed and metabolized in the body, the short and long-term effects of drinking alcohol, and then the different forms of alcohol abuse and consequences of that abuse. We also talked about the reason people start smoking and why they continue, short and long-term health risks. And then we concluded with some strategies to either reduce use or avoid it altogether as far as smoking tobacco, as far as environmental tobacco use, and then alcohol use. So I hope you took a few minutes throughout the week to think on what you learned out of that chapter. And maybe how it can help you, your friends, and your family. Today, what I'd like to do, instead of focusing so much on a behavior, we're going to look at heart disease and cancer. By the time we finish the broadcast, by the time you finished reading and studying chapter 12, you should be able to list the major components of the cardiovascular system, how blood is pumped through the heart and circulated through the body. You should be able to describe the controllable and uncontrollable risk factors associated with cardiovascular disease. You should be able to discuss the major forms of cardiovascular disease. And then you should also be able to explain what cancer is, how it spreads, describe some of the common cancers, and then list some steps to lower your personal risk of cardiovascular disease and cancer. So today's a little different than what we've been doing because we've really been focused on the behaviors. So in focusing on the disease, we're actually focusing on two categories of chronic disease that are really impacted by all the behaviors we've been talking about so far, and possibly a few more to come. So I'd certainly like, as I review some of the information that you find in your text, for you to participate in this afternoon's discussion. So my question of the day is pretty open-ended again. What key information did you learn from the chapter? And then what can you do to reduce your risk of heart disease and cancer? So what did you learn, and what did you take out of this chapter that you can actually do to take care of yourself? So I invite you to provide your response to those two questions. You can either call me, there's the 800 number, or you can email me, and that email address is right there. Share with me what you learned and what you plan on doing. And then as we have some breaks in the discussion, I will take your calls and take those emails and share with all of us who are taking the class. So I encourage you to do so. And while you are formulating your response and getting that email in, or you decide to give me a call. Let's go ahead and get started on just some background information to get us up and going. So let's talk first in our first half of our broadcast about cardiovascular disease. And so to lay some groundwork, the reason these two chronic diseases are grouped together is that they cover the top three leading causes of death in this country. Cardiovascular disease affects more than 81 million Americans, and it is the leading cause of death in the United States. A life every 38 seconds is lost to heart disease. That's about 2,300 individuals every single day. Heart attacks and strokes are the number one and number three causes of death, respectfully. Cancer is the second leading cause of death in the United States, claiming nearly 70,000 lives annually. That's more than 1,500 each day. So those diseases take those top three positions in leading causes of death. And although age and genetics and environment do play some role in the development of cardiovascular diseases and cancers, really what we are looking at when we look at these diseases are lifestyle diseases linked to many controllable lifestyle factors. So that's why we can look at these diseases and then reflect back on a lot of the lifestyle behaviors that we've been talking about so far this semester. So let's first just do a really quick review of the cardiovascular system. This is going to take you back to your science classes, your anatomy and physiology courses. And what I'd like to do is to show a video clip entitled How the Heart Works, and that will give you a very quick review of what goes on in this cardiovascular system. So let's take a look at that video clip.
Your heart is a pump. It's a muscular organ about the size of your fist and is located slightly left of center in your chest. Your heart is divided into the right and left side. The division protects oxygen-rich blood from mixing with oxygen-poor blood. Together, your heart and blood vessels comprise your cardiovascular system, which circulates blood and oxygen around your body. In fact, your heart pumps about 5 quarts of blood every minute, and it beats about 100,000 times in one day. That's about 35 million times in a year. Oxygen-poor blood, blue blood, returns to the heart after circulating through your body. The right side of the heart, composed of the right atrium and ventricle, collects and pumps the blood to the lungs through the pulmonary arteries. The lungs refresh the blood with a new supply of oxygen, making it turn red. Oxygen-rich blood, red blood, then enters the left side of the heart, composed of the left atrium and ventricle, and is pumped through the aorta to the body to supply tissues with oxygen. 4 valves within your heart keep your blood moving the right way: the tricuspid, mitral, pulmonary, and aortic valves work like gates on a fence. They open only one way and only when pushed on. Each valve opens and closes once per heartbeat, or about once every second. A beating heart contracts and relaxes. Contraction is called systole, and relaxing is called diastole. During systole, your ventricles contract, forcing blood into the vessels going to your lungs and body, much like ketchup being forced out of a squeeze bottle. The right ventricle contracts a little bit before the left ventricle does. Your ventricles then relax during diastole and are filled with blood coming from the upper chambers, the left and right atria. Then the cycle starts over again. Your heart is nourished by blood too. Blood vessels, called coronary arteries, extend over the surface of your heart and branch into smaller capillaries. Here you can see just the network of blood vessels that feed your heart with oxygen-rich blood. Your heart also has electrical wiring, which keeps it beating. Electrical impulses begin high in the right atrium and travel through specialized pathways to the ventricles, delivering the signal to pump. The conduction system keeps your heart beating in a coordinated and normal rhythm, which in turn keeps blood circulating. The continuous exchange of oxygen-rich blood with oxygen-poor blood is what keeps you alive.
Okay, a quick review of the heart and how all of that works together. Veins carrying blood away from the heart or to the heart, and arteries carrying that oxygenated blood away from the heart and into all areas of the body. That blockage of that coronary artery that was identified, those arteries that feed the heart itself, leading cause of death. You will hear about coronary artery disease. That's those arteries. And then when we talk about hypertension or high blood pressure, it's not just a risk factor for cardiovascular disease, but it is a type of cardiovascular disease in and of itself. So let's look at some of the major risk factors for cardiovascular disease. There are several. And quite a few of them we've already addressed. First is tobacco use. 1 in 5 deaths is attributable to smoking. People who smoke a pack of cigarettes a day have twice the risk of heart attack as a non-smoker. People who smoke 2 packs of cigarettes a day have that risk tripled. And literally, smokers who have heart attacks are much more likely than non-smokers to die as a result of those. Remember that smoking actually damages the lining of the arteries. Nicotine increases blood pressure and heart rate. Smoking causes those platelets in the blood to stick together in the bloodstream, so that leads to clotting, which may lead to obstructions. Don't forget that you don't have to be a smoker to be affected by that. That environmental tobacco smoke also increases our risk of heart disease by about 30%. So certainly tobacco use is a factor for heart disease. Also high blood pressure, as we've talked about, it is a risk and it's a risk factor, and it's considered a cardiovascular disease in and of itself. Remember that blood pressure is the force that's exerted by the blood onto those artery walls, and it's really caused by pumping action. So when you have high blood pressure, you've got extra force being exerted. Basically, what you're doing is the heart is having to work harder than normal to force that blood through those narrowed, stiffened arteries. So that has an impact not only on the heart muscle itself, but also on those arteries. Death rates from cardiovascular disease certainly elevate as soon as blood pressure starts to elevate. If you have blood pressure over 115, over 75, that's starting to increase your risk for heart disease. And certainly hypertension is not formally diagnosed until your blood pressure is 140 over 90. But even in that pre-hypertensive state, you're starting to see negative effects. And certainly hypertension is common But we see it more as individuals age, highest in African American groups. And so it is a factor that we really need to look at. Another one of those factors that can be controlled is high cholesterol. Certainly that substance, that fatty substance that circulates through the blood may actually cause some of that clotting, increases your risk for cardiovascular disease. Also, it has an impact on your liver because your liver is trying to cleanse all of that out. And remember that cholesterol is carried in the blood by these protein lipid packages called lipoproteins. And so we've got two that we are particularly interested in as we look at risk for cardiovascular disease. The low-density lipoproteins, or what we call LDLs, basically act as the bad cholesterol. There's typically more than the body can use, so that excess is deposited in the blood vessels. And so that may lead to either a blockage or, if in the coronary arteries, a heart attack. If it's in the brain, it may cause a stroke. High-density lipoproteins are called good cholesterols. They basically keep things moving and processed through the liver, and they actually protect the vessels from atherosclerosis. But we certainly know that while our HDL and LDL is affected by genetics, it's also affected by what we eat. So we can certainly reduce some of our LDL, that bad cholesterol, by increasing fiber and decreasing those saturated and trans fats. And we can raise our good cholesterol by eating more fruits and vegetables, by exercising more, by eating fish and whole grains. So while there is that genetic component, certainly we can do a few things with it ourselves, just in diet. Some of the other major risk factors for cardiovascular disease is obesity. Death from cardiovascular disease is 2 to 3 times more likely in obese individuals. And so I've got a little video clip again to look at how obesity raises heart disease risk. Let's see that one.
So how does obesity increase your risk of heart disease? Well, the first thing to say is that obesity is a major risk factor for heart disease. Obesity increases the risk for heart disease in 2 main ways. One is obviously you're not getting the benefits of regular exercise. Those benefits are a reduction in blood pressure, cholesterol, and overall well-being. But in addition to that, obesity itself can lead to heart disease. It leads to a lot of changes in metabolism, or the way the body works. It can change the way we absorb fats and cholesterol. It can change the way we react to daily stress. And it can change our body's physiology to lead to things like high blood pressure. How obesity leads to heart disease is a very important problem in the United States. Obesity is an epidemic in the US. And in fact, 50% of Americans are overweight, and 1/3 of Americans are obese. And this number is only increasing. So it's become a real problem. Obesity leads to a lot of change in the body, which can have detrimental effects. It can directly impact the heart's function, leading to a promotion of development of atherosclerosis, or blocked arteries in the heart, a weakening of the heart muscle, and an increased chance of arrhythmias, or abnormal heart rhythms. The treatment would be to adopt a more heart-healthy lifestyle, to change the way we eat, making healthy choices, increase our cardiovascular exercise, and decrease the amount of stress in life. So obesity definitely leads to increased rates of cardiovascular disease, but changing our lifestyles can definitely help reduce that risk.
Okay, so we've talked about obesity earlier in the semester as we talked about nutrition and physical activity. So certainly, again, here we see that increased risk of cardiovascular disease. Another one of the diseases that we touched on in talking about nutrition and physical activity was the chronic disease of diabetes. Elevated blood glucose levels, because either we have an insufficient supply of insulin, or the insulin and the receptors aren't working like they're supposed to. So let's take a quick look at a video clip on diabetes and heart disease.
An estimated 32 million Americans have been diagnosed with diabetes. While this disease primarily affects blood sugar levels, the disease can also put a significant strain on your heart. In tonight's Avera Medical Minute, Jake Iverson explains why, for diabetics, staying on top of your blood sugar is just the first step.
Diabetes and obesity numbers are expanding faster than the average American waistband. As the weight of the nation increases, heart disease is rising right alongside.
We found that diabetes actually has the same risk factor association as someone who's already had one heart attack.
In fact, for men, having diabetes doubles their risk of heart attack. Women, it triples it. Whether it's type 1 or type 2, if you have diabetes, staying on top of your medication is only the first step.
Just taking a pill is not going to be sufficient for what you'd want to try to decrease your risk for heart disease.
That's because diabetes increases the strain on your circulatory system, putting your kidneys, blood vessels, and more importantly, your very life in jeopardy.
It has to do with damage to the inside layers of the blood vessels. So what happens is they get this damage to the inside of the blood vessels causes development of cholesterol plaques in between the layers of arteries. So they develop cholesterol plaques and a higher risk for obstructive heart disease as well as heart attacks earlier than folks who don't have diabetes.
With all that plaque buildup, many people lose nerve sensations throughout their bodies, making it hard to tell if they're even having a heart attack.
Symptoms of shortness of breath, they may have more symptoms, for example, in their jaw or their neck or their shoulders. So the perception of a pain due to the nerve changes can be altered in diabetic folks.
Like every other cardiac condition, exercise and getting off the couch is the best way to beat diabetes. Keeping on top of your blood sugar is also critical, but having diabetes should be all the motivation to make sure you're living a healthy life.
Absolutely. If you have diabetes or pre-diabetes, it should serve as a warning indicator that you want to assess all your risk factors, see your doctor, anything that needs to be adjusted, anything you can modify from a risk factor standpoint is what you'd want to do to minimize your chance to need cardiologists like us.
Not that Dr. Rand doesn't want to see you, he just doesn't want to see you here on the operating table. With your Avera Medical Minute, I'm Jake Iverson, KSFY News.
Diabetes can cause more than just an increased heart disease risk and should be taken very seriously. For more information about diabetes and heart disease.
Okay, so major risk factors for cardiovascular disease include tobacco use, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, obesity, and diabetes. So we want to keep those issues at mind and think about what we can do to minimize some of that risk. Now, there are some contributing risk factors that can be changed by our lifestyle. And so let's go through a few of those. First, high triglyceride levels. So like cholesterol, triglycerides are blood fats. They come from food as well as being manufactured in the body. And our triglyceride level is actually a pretty good predictor of heart disease. So often when you go in for your physical and they take blood for all of the blood tests, this is one of the tests that they are looking specifically at. Certainly elevated triglycerides, is impacted by excess body fat, physical inactivity, cigarette smoking, type 2 diabetes, excessive alcohol intake, high carbohydrate diets, and then of course some diseases and medications. So again, you're hearing some of these same lifestyle behaviors addressed again and again. So really give some thought to what it is that you are doing. There are some psychological and social factors that also can contribute to heart disease that can be changed. The first is stress. Certainly that strains the heart. It can increase heart rate, increase heart, blood pressure. So we are at risk. So one of the things that we can change is to diminish that stress level, manage that so we don't see those big spikes in stress. Another thing that we can change is chronic hostility and anger. You know, that hard-driving type A personality often associated with that hostility tends to increase your risk of a heart attack. So, you know, being calm not only diminishes some of that stress, but our hostile or angry responses. Depression is also shown to increase risk of cardiovascular disease. So certainly dealing with depressive episodes is important, as is chronic anxiety and any of the anxiety disorders. Remember, we talked about those very early in the semester. Social isolation and low social support. So living alone or having few friends or family members is also associated with increased risk for cardiovascular disease, as is low socioeconomic level and low educational attainment. And probably these last two are related to many of the other factors, including those lifestyle behaviors, but also even access to healthcare. One of the other contributing factors that we can change is our use of alcohol and drugs. Though moderate drinking may have some positive impact for some people, drinking too much certainly increases blood pressure, increases our risk of stroke and heart failure. Those categories of drugs that we talked about, the stimulants, certainly also increase our risk for that. And then injection drug use can introduce infection into the bloodstream, which can affect the heart, which can then affect either heart disease or stroke. So those are some things that you can change. And certainly as you read that part of the chapter, this is where we really want to spend some time and energy in reflecting on what can I do for my own health. There are some major factors that cannot be changed. These we just have to deal with, but we have to recognize that we have these. First is heredity, genetic makeup. There is a genetic link with heart disease, particularly high cholesterol, hypertension, diabetes, and obesity. So certainly if you have a genetic risk, you really want to look at any of those lifestyle factors that you can change to minimize that risk. Another risk is aging. About 70% of all heart attack victims are 65 or older. 75% of those who suffer fatal heart attacks are over 65. And for people over 55, the incidence of stroke more than doubles for each successive 10 years. But what we are seeing because of the lifestyle factors is we are seeing people in their 30s and 40s demonstrating cardiovascular disease, including major heart attacks. So we can't change aging, but again, we can do lots to make sure that as we age, we are engaging in healthy behaviors. Another thing that we cannot change is our gender. Although cardiovascular disease is a killer of both men and women, men actually face greater risk of heart attack than women. On average, women live 10 to 15 more years free of coronary heart disease than men do. Unfortunately, women underestimate their risk of dying from a heart attack. They tend to think, oh, I'm probably die of breast cancer, when in fact, it probably will be heart disease. So certainly women with risk factors or lifestyle factors need to be very aware of how they feel and communicate that with your medical professional. Sometimes medical professionals tend to look more to men with the heart attack issues than women. A very common response to women to a pending heart episode is just that general feeling of, I feel awful. Maybe a little nausea, maybe some headache. They typically do not have the classic signs of heart attack that men demonstrate in the fact of that crushing chest pain radiating into their right arms. So we as women need to be very aware of how we feel and take action more quickly than most of us do. Another thing that we cannot change is our ethnicity. Rates of heart disease vary among ethnic groups. African Americans having a much higher rate of hypertension, heart disease, and stroke. Puerto Rican Americans, Cuban Americans, Mexican Americans are also more likely to suffer from high blood pressure and angina. And that's a warning sign of heart disease. We'll talk a little bit more about that. Historically, Asian Americans have had far lower rates of cardiovascular disease than white Americans. But certainly remember that your ethnic background, while it may or may not influence, again, we have to look at those lifestyle behaviors that we engage in. All right, so those are some things that we cannot change. So, you know, we are stuck with those, but we are not doomed to a life of cardiovascular disease and premature death because we can modify several of those behaviors. All right, so let's just quickly look at some of the major forms of cardiovascular disease. Heart diseases kill, back in 2006, so quite a while back, 10 years, over 600,000 individuals in this country. So let's take a look at another video. Are you at risk for heart disease? And then again, what is it? So let's take a look at this quick one.
Heart disease is a little like car trouble. It's a big term. It refers to a lot of different things, and the car is a complex machinery like the heart. So the heart has four parts. It has the pumping part, the muscle. It has the electrical system that provides the stimulus to beat. It has the muscle itself, the valves that keep the blood going in one direction. And it has a set of arteries, the coronary arteries, that bring blood to this muscle that is working all the time, even when you sleep. And heart disease in general refers to disease of the arteries, but there's valvular heart disease, there's electrical heart disease, there's disease of the muscle of the heart, which can get infected, say, by viruses. It all is heart disease, but in general, because it's so much more common than any of the other heart diseases, coronary artery disease, or atherosclerotic coronary artery disease, the buildup of cholesterol in the arteries, is by far the most common form of heart disease. Well, atherosclerotic coronary artery disease, that sort of heart disease, the most common, is the leading cause of death in adults over 35 in the industrial world. So this year alone, in America, there'll be a million heart attacks. It's estimated that more than 50% of men and nearly 40% of women will have atherosclerotic coronary disease problem before they die. So that's a huge number. There are a couple of important risk factors: smoking, diabetes, kidney disease, high blood pressure, elevated blood cholesterol, and very importantly, an immediate family history of heart disease. So these are cutaways of a progression from a disease-free artery to an artery that has a little bit of yellow cholesterol buildup, to an artery in which the plaque, the buildup of cholesterol, has started to erupt like a pimple, causing a blood clot to form in the artery. And finally, to an artery that's totally blocked by clot, and that's what happens with a heart attack. A heart attack, once it starts, has about 2 hours before all the heart that's fed by the artery that blocked dies. The time element is so critical that the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association makes it a primary goal for a heart center to perform an angioplasty within 90 minutes of a patient's arrival at the emergency room if they're having a heart attack. This is hard to do. There are 8 or 9 staff members that have to be assembled. The equipment has to be geared up, especially if it's 2 in the morning, that's not easy. But we do it, and in fact, we do it more than 90% of the time. But we're always trying to discover people with heart disease earlier and earlier. And in general, cardiologists are succeeding because deaths from heart disease are going down as a proportion of the population, but not by as much as we'd like. It's something that we have to keep working at, both from the clinician's point of view and from the general education of the population of America and the world in terms of diet, lifestyle, exercise, and all that.
Okay, so in that video clip, it was a good review of atherosclerosis, that thickening and hardening of the arteries. He also talked about heart disease and heart attack. Both of those are addressed in your text. So you can look at that video clip, take a look at what's in the text. One of the other things that's brought out in your text is around angina. And I mentioned that earlier, and it really wasn't talked about in the video clip. But this is where the arteries that have been narrowed, though they're still open, they need more oxygen, and they can actually get to a state where the need for oxygen exceeds the supply of oxygen. And so actually there is a pain associated with that, and that is called angina pectoris. And that angina pain is extreme. It can be treated with medications, can be treated with non-surgical procedures, but certainly this is something that folks with heart disease fear because it does hurt. It is certainly a warning sign of potential damage and potential risk for heart attack. The other thing that we look at with cardiovascular disease are also the arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death. And the arrhythmias are caused by this inadequate or uneven electrical surge. The heart is not pumping in that nice rhythmic motion that it should. So oftentimes when the heart becomes very irregular in its pumping, we see sudden cardiac death. Some arrhythmias do not cause problems other than the discomfort to an individual. So certainly if you notice that your heartbeat is not steady and consistent, or it feels like a flutter, that's something you certainly want to let your healthcare provider know about. Okay, another part of this cardiovascular disease picture is that of stroke. A stroke is a cerebrovascular accident. So instead of it being associated with the heart, it's the vessels in the brain. And there are two major kinds of stroke. There is ischemic, and that's basically the blockage of a blood vessel. So you've got a couple of different types of that stroke. And the other is hemorrhagic stroke. And that's where the blood vessel actually bursts, spilling out blood into the surrounding tissue. Both can be severe. The hemorrhagic, obviously, because you've got this uncontrolled blood flow into tissue, can be extremely severe, life-threatening. It can happen in the brain. It can happen in an artery around the heart. And that's those aneurysms, that bulging of these vessels when they break that actually can lead to a stroke. So there are some things that you need to know as far as detecting and treating stroke. Some really simple things that you can remember for signs of a stroke. And I have a video clip for that. Can we see signs of a stroke?
Warning signs. Throughout our lives, we learn their importance and what they mean. Flashing lights alert you of construction on the highway. A loud siren lets you know about a fire drill in your office. Cell phones can even inform you when bad weather is headed your way. However, a lot of people aren't familiar with the warning signs for the fourth leading cause of death in the United States, stroke. A stroke can happen in a moment's notice, so it's important to detect the warning signs. If you spot facial drooping, sudden arm weakening, or trouble speaking, like slurred speech, then it's time to call 911. These signs can come on suddenly, so get help immediately if you identify any of these signs in yourself or someone around you. The longer a stroke goes unnoticed, the more damage is done. That's why it is important to act fast.
All right, so keep in mind that reminder fast. When you notice facial drooping, when you notice that arm strength is unequal, you notice slurred speech, it is now time to call 911 quickly. So keep that all in mind. The last form of cardiovascular disease that I just want to briefly mention is congestive heart failure. And basically, this is involvement of the cardiovascular system and body fluids. Basically, the heart has been damaged enough that the fluids back up into tissue. So you see a lot of swelling, or what's called edema. Legs and ankles, sometimes hands and arms. If that fluid collects in the lungs, certainly interference with breathing. So several types of cardiovascular disease. You certainly want to pay close attention as you read chapter 12 and think about all of these different types. And then, of course, we want to get to the part where we're protecting ourselves against cardiovascular disease. And before I start, end with some of that, I just want to look at some of your comments that you're sending in. Thank you so much for doing that. Glicelda is here and says that I learned that heart disease is the leading cause of death, and to lower my risk, I'm going to stay active, keep a healthy diet, and make sure I don't participate in things that hurt my health, such as smoking. Thanks, Glicelda. All right, Jasmine, I'm going to skip yours because that's over last week's chapter on alcohol and tobacco. So what have we got after Jasmine? Sophia, glad you're here. Sophia says that she learned about the two large vessels, the right and left coronary arteries, and how they branch off the aorta. So a little bit of that biology came back to mind. And in order to prevent cardiovascular disease and cancer, Sophia is going to stay active. Can we scroll down? Stay active, eat well so that she gets proper vitamins and minerals, and go to the doctor and to help make your health plan and stay healthy. Good for you. Thanks for sharing that. Okay, Mark, glad you're here. I learned the difference between bad and good cholesterol, and I learned that I can reduce the risk of heart disease by controlling that cholesterol. Okay, good. So you're really looking at some dietary changes. Cecilia says that factors that help reduce risk of heart disease and cancer, again, changes in diet, increase in physical activity, reduction in meat, certain types of fats, alcohol, and tobacco. All right, so it sounds like you know a few things you can do. And Connor Glad you are here. Connor says, I think the best way to keep your heart healthy is to eat right and exercise regularly. Those are two really good ways. And Kai, glad you are here. What I learned about from the chapter is how the cardiovascular system works, what factors contribute to cardiovascular disease. And certainly she's learned about some different lifestyle factors. So going to engage in more physical activity, making some dietary changes to lower cholesterol and moderate alcohol consumption. All right, good job. Thank you for sharing. And hi, Erin, how are you? Erin says that I learned that our diet, the things that we eat and the exercise are some of the simple things we can do to avoid cardiovascular disease. And things such as smoking only make us more susceptible to forms of the disease. All right, great. Thank you, each and every one of you, for your responses to the question of the day. And I think most of you really summed up how to protect yourself from cardiovascular disease. That very first and foremost one that comes up again and again is to eat heart healthy. When we look at what we are going to put in our stomachs, think about your heart. So looking at total fat intake, increasing your fiber, increasing whole grains. So we're eating lots of fruits and vegetables. You want to limit fat and cholesterol. And you can really do that by watching those fatty meats that we eat and eat more lean protein and fish. And again, eating lots of the fruits and vegetables and increasing fiber. So we're going to eat a heart-healthy diet, limit fat and cholesterol, increase our fiber, reduce sodium and potassium, decrease some of those salt levels. That really impacts blood pressure. And then decrease alcohol consumption. We know that excess alcohol consumption increases risk of a variety of serious health problems, but certainly cardiovascular. So, these are all very much related to, that diet. Heart-healthy diet, limiting fat and cholesterol, increasing fiber, reducing sodium, decreasing alcohol, and reduce our total calories. Is that last one around diet. Again, because oftentimes we eat far too much. We want to balance what we eat with exercising regularly. We cannot just think about what we eat, but we've got to keep moving. And there is such strong evidence that physical activity has significant benefits in reducing cardiovascular disease. That some physicians actually prescribe it as a treatment. And we should all kind of take that to heart. Okay, we have run through a lot of information here in the first half of our broadcast. I do want to give you a break because I want you to think about something heart healthy you can eat. Engage in some real quick physical activity. Drink some water. Come back in 5 minutes and we will look at cancer. All right, so I'll see you in 5.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school was for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it, the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. Hope you had a good quick break. I have a couple more responses I want to read to you. Again, regarding what folks have learned from this week's reading and some things that they can do. Jasmine, glad you are here and on the right week. The information that Jasmine learned was really about the cardiovascular system and those risk factors that lead to cardiovascular disease. Also learned about some common cancers and their risk factors, signs and symptoms, and the treatments, also the approaches to prevention. So what she's gonna do is look at exercise, diet, smoking, because they certainly all take a toll, and then anyone at any age can benefit from some simple steps to keep their heart healthy during each decade of their life. And I think that's the answer, is that there are lots of things we can do them, and that makes each one go just a little bit better. So thanks for that. And Trinity, thank you for being here as well. Trinity says, what I can do to reduce my risk for cardiovascular disease: eat better, engage in more physical activities, and stay aware of psychological problems that could, or physiological problems, excuse me, that could arise, that could produce that rise in blood pressure. really kind of keep all of that under control. All right, good for you. Jazz, for heart disease, exercise is the best way to minimize that risk. What I learned from this chapter is the risk of being obese is a major risk for cardiovascular disease. All right, yeah, a lot of these diseases are very much linked together. And a lot of the behaviors are very much linked together. All right, so let's shift our focus from heart disease, and now let's focus on cancer. Cancer is the second leading cause of death in this country. And really, cancer is the abnormal, uncontrolled multiplication of cells. And it can cause death if left untreated. So I've got a quick video clip that will kind of review for us what is cancer.
You have a 43% chance of getting it and a 23% chance of dying from it. It's cancer. There's tons of information and many common misconceptions about cancer. Of course, there's so much information we can't go over everything, but this video will hopefully go over some of the main points. Cancer is an abnormal growth of cells that has the potential to spread to different areas. A tumor is just a growth of cells, which can be benign, which won't spread, or malignant, which is indeed cancerous. Many people will generalize thinking that all tumors are cancerous, which just isn't true. On the other hand, many tumors will change over time and could become cancerous. 95% of cancers are caused by environmental factors, and only 5% from genetics. The most common causes are obesity, tobacco, viral infections, radiation, and environmental pollutants. Cancer is pretty darn scary because it can happen to anybody at any time, but you can lower your chances by being overall healthy, not using tobacco or drugs, and getting your vaccinations. The news tries to scare people by saying basically everything causes cancer, and even though that's partially true, you shouldn't be afraid of everything. Precancerous cells are actually somewhat common in everybody's body. So why don't we all get cancer? Our body has tons of defense mechanisms against it. Precancerous cells will receive anti-growth signals, will be attacked by our immune system, and often go through apoptosis, which is killing themselves. When all of these cancer defense mechanisms fail, or there are too many precancerous cells for our bodies to fight off, cancer will occur. Once our bodies fail at controlling it, modern medicine still has plenty of ways to fight it, though. Chemotherapy, radiation therapy, surgery, immunotherapy, and others are all great ways to assist your body in fighting off the cancer. There will likely never be one way to defeat all cancers, but hopefully with the millions of dollars we pour into research every year, we'll find better and easier ways to defeat those evil cells.
All right, so the role of DNA, it does have some impact on causing cancer. But remember in that video clip, as far as the causes of cancer, about 5% of an impact with genetics or that role of DNA. But it's 95% related to environmental issues. And so when we think about environmental issues, specifically with cancer, one of the first things I think about is tobacco use. So again, tobacco, and as we talked about earlier, responsible for 80 to 90% of lung cancers and about 30% of all other cancer deaths. So I have a quick video here again for you on the link between smoking and lung cancer. Can we have that one now?
Thank you.
Okay, so I think that's a pretty good reminder of the impact that tobacco use has on cancer. Here again, when we look at some of those causes of cancer, the next one we look at is dietary factors. Foods that we eat, particularly those fatty foods, those typically fatty meats, really do impact a variety of cancer. They produce a lot of the cancerous compounds. However, when you are looking at some of the dietary things that may inhibit or reduce your risk of cancer, we want to look at omega-3 foods. So think about that when you're choosing some of your foods. In addition to dietary factors, alcohol is very much linked with the increased incidence of several kinds of cancers. Women who drink 2 to 5 drinks daily have about 1.5 times the risk for cancer that women who do not drink alcohol have. And then, of course, because alcohol is often used with tobacco, they interact and increase the risk for oral or mouth cancers. Another environmental factor that may play a role in causing cancer are fried foods. Science has found that some of those foods that are fried or baked at very high temperatures may increase the incidence of cancer. And then, of course, we also have to think about the carcinogens in our environment. Some of those carcinogens, those cancer-causing substances, may be viruses. They may be the ultraviolet rays that are emitted by the sun. But there are also a number of man-made or produced carcinogens from toxic chemicals, from general work environments, et cetera. So we really have to think about even specific work industries and what might increase the risk of cancer in those who work in those industries. So let's take a look at some common cancers. And just a quick refresher for you all. So when we look at common cancers, these are the most common. This is not the end all. But we've made certain reference to lung cancer. Lung cancer is the most common cause of cancer death in the United States. And you just saw that in that video clip. While death rates of the other cancers may be decreasing, the death rate from lung cancer certainly is not. And certainly lung cancer is linked to tobacco. It is often very hard to detect early on. So sometimes folks don't know that they have it until it is widespread throughout the lungs. Another common cancer that you will hear about is colon and rectal cancer. While this is the third most common type of cancers, certainly age is a factor here. More than 90% of the cases are diagnosed in adults over the age of 50. There may be some genetic influence here, but very often associated with excess alcohol use, smoking, and diets low in fiber. So again, you're seeing some of the same behavior things affect throughout all of these different types of cancer. Certainly, we can screen for colon cancer. Colonoscopies are currently recommended for individuals over the age of 55, but some new information coming out with this increasing incidence in 30 and 40-year-olds, they are looking at the possibility of changing some of those recommendations to start screening at an earlier age. Another common form of cancer is breast cancer. This is the most common cancer in women. About one woman in eight will develop breast cancer during her lifetime. One in 30 will die from the disease. Less than 2% of breast cancer occurs in women under the age of 35. So certainly age plays a role here. There is a strong genetic marker for breast cancer. So certainly knowing your family history is going to be important to know to determine your own risk. But again, not all breast cancer is linked to that familial trait. So again, this is another reason to participate in breast cancer screenings. Certainly you can do self-exams at home, but then when you go to your healthcare provider, he or she will do breast exams. And again, looking for changes in breast tissue that might indicate breast cancer. Another common cancer, and this one is for the guys, is prostate cancer. It is the most common cancer in men, second leading cause of cancer death. And age is the strongest predictor for this kind of cancer. Over 60% of the cases do occur in men over 65. There is, again, some genetic marker for this. So, again, knowing family history is going to be really important. Dietary factors seem to influence this particular cancer as well. Also, a history of sexually transmitted diseases may play a role in prostate cancer. Another one of the common cancers, the ones that you will hear about, is cervical cancer. And this is the cancer of the cervix. Occurs frequently in women in their 30s, sometimes even down into their 20s. Virtually all cases of cervical cancer stem from an infection of human papillomavirus, HPV. That's a group. There's about 100 different related viruses. Typically transmitted by a sexual partner, these viruses infect the cervical cells, causing this uncontrolled division and growth. HPV is thought to be responsible for about 99% of cervical cancers. But there's good news here in the fact that there are two HPV vaccines currently approved by the FDA, and everybody, male and female, should get the HPV. So let's take a look at that next video clip. Should you get the HPV vaccination?
Hey everyone, Julia here for DNews. The HPV vaccine has been around for almost a decade. Gardasil and its counterpart Cervarix protect against the disease by using virus-like particles to boost your immune system. The vaccine has been mostly targeted towards young women, but new research could change that. A recent study published in the journal Epidemics found that vaccinating boys might be a kind of two-for-one deal. Protect more people with the same price. With limited budgets for the CDC and other health organizations, it's important to find the best approach for the least amount of money. The researchers say that even though currently a smaller percentage of women are vaccinated than what's ideal, it might be cheaper to increase the percentage of boys vaccinated than work on increasing coverage in the ladies. So it's recommended that both boys and girls get vaccinated around 11 to 12 years old before they're ever exposed to HPV. But some parents are opposed to it for a few reasons. Some are worried it could encourage risky behavior, or some parents just flat out don't like vaccines. So let's say that 38% of young women have been vaccinated and 14% of young men have. Getting more girls vaccinated gets more expensive as it takes extra measures to convince skeptical parents. But parents of boys might not need convincing so much as simply educating. At the end of the day, more people are vaccinated and more people are protected. But what is HPV? Like its name suggests, it's a virus, human papillomavirus. And it's a sexually transmitted infection. You can get it from vaginal, anal, and oral sex. and it's surprisingly common. The CDC says that most sexually active people will get at least one strain of the virus at some point in their lives. While some people's immune system can fight it off, for some it can lead to cancer. HPV causes nearly all cases of cervical cancers, which is one reason why the vaccine might be targeted towards mostly women. So you think boys wouldn't have to worry so much about HPV even if they do get it. But HPV can cause other types of cancer, like oral and throat cancer, which men can get. According to the CDC, a third of HPV-caused cancer cases in the US each year occur in men. The actor Michael Douglas made headlines when he was diagnosed with throat cancer in 2013. According to a study published in the Journal of Clinical Oncology, cases of these types of cancers are on the rise. But that's one of the reasons why HPV vaccines are so exciting! They have the potential to rid the world of certain types of cancer in the same way that polio and measles are no longer a thing. That's awesome. Gardasil, the most popular, protects against four HPV strains, two of which, according to the World Health Organization, cause 70% of all cases of cervical cancer. Another study published in the New England Journal of Medicine found that if uninfected people are vaccinated with Gardasil 9, a new version of the vaccine, 90% of all cervical cancers could be prevented. This could save over 260,000 lives a year. So why don't more people get it? Well, it's part of mandatory vaccine programs in Australia, and the NHS in the UK offers it, but there's been a fear it can lead to risky sexual behavior in teens. However, one study published in the Canadian Medical Association Journal found no increase in sexual activity in teenage girls, so there's really no reason not to get it. On an unrelated note, we've been reading your comments and we hear you. We know many of you miss the old D-News set. Well, if you love it so much, why don't you wear it? We've got awesome t-shirts you can buy with the vintage D-News.
Okay, we really didn't need the commercial for the channel, but it had some really good information. And certainly, you want to check your own vaccination history and talk with your healthcare provider to see if you need the HPV vaccine or if you've had it in the past and are good to go for a while. It really does make a significant impact on a very common cancer. The last, I've got two more cancers to talk about. One of them I'm just gonna mention. Ovarian cancer, or cancer of the ovaries, is very rare compared to cervical or even uterine cancer, but it causes more death. So if you are hearing about ovarian cancer, I just want you to keep that in mind, as we hear a lot about it because of its death, its impact by death, but certainly not as common. And easily detected through pap tests, a few other screening methods. So again, another reason to get to your healthcare provider. The last of the cancers that I want to talk about is skin cancer. And skin cancer is the most common cancer of all when cases of highly curable forms are included in this. When we look at skin cancer, we're looking at more than 1 million cases diagnosed each year. About 68,000 of them are that serious form known as melanoma. For most cancers, the treatments are very simple and highly successful. Melanoma is the one that we certainly have more difficulty with. Risk factor for skin cancer really is exposure to the sun. It's that ultraviolet radiation from the sun causes sunburns, causes our skin to age, and causes that damage to skin. We certainly know that Caucasians are 10 times more likely than African Americans to develop melanoma, but do not be fooled. Just because you have a darker skin tone does not mean that you are not at risk. Certainly severe sunburns at childhood have been linked to this increased risk of skin cancer. So there are three main types of skin cancer. When we talk about skin cancer, we talk about basal cell, squamous cell, and those are about 95% of the skin cancers. Those are in the areas that are chronically exposed to the sun. They are typically painless and can be easily treated. Melanoma is that dangerous one because it spreads so rapidly. Usually starts out at the site of an existing mole. So that mole starts to change. And so I've got one more video. This one's called Dear 16-Year-Old Me. Thoughts that folks would like to have told their younger selves. Let's see that one.
Dear 16-Year-Old Me.
Dear 16-Year-Old Me.
Dear 16-Year-Old Me.
Please don't get that perm. It's not as awesome as you think it's going
to
be.
You have to actually practice in order to learn to play guitar.
Whiskey tastes even worse on the way up.
Dear 16-Year-Old Me. There's going to be a new set of Star Wars movies. Don't watch them. They ruin everything.
Dear 16-Year-Old Me. This is where they took the cancer out. It was something called melanoma.
It's called malignant melanoma.
Malignant melanoma.
Malignant? That's not a very friendly word.
You'll be diagnosed when you're 28.
18.
36.
29.
22.
It's a tumor that starts in your skin cells, the cells that give your hair and skin color.
It's not just skin cancer.
Well, it is.
Well, it is.
But not just the
cut it out and it'll be fine kind, unfortunately.
It's the kind that you have to catch before it spreads.
Because it spreads so fast.
So fast.
To places like your liver, your lungs, your brain. Yours will be a really rare kind in your left eye. And that's when you'll find out.
That melanoma can show up on your tongue, the palms of your hands, and the soles of your feet.
Your doctors will tell you you're lucky that you caught it early.
Yours will tell you that you need aggressive treatment.
I'll have to tell you it might take a year of chemotherapy.
And you'll need to do some of the injections yourself.
Dear 16-year-old me.
You're doing okay.
You're strong.
But there are some things I want you to know.
I wish I'd known.
That one bad sunburn before you turn 18
doubles your chances of developing melanoma.
That fair skin and red hair means that you're at a higher risk of getting it.
As if ginger people didn't have enough problems.
That you're at higher risk if you've got more than 50 moles.
And if you have a weakened immune system or a family history of skin cancer.
I want you to know the outlook is very good if we can catch it early.
But you have less than a 10% chance of surviving more than 5 years if we don't.
Dear 16-year-old me.
Spend more time with family. They mean everything.
If I had one piece of advice for you, don't start the tanning bed. I know you want a healthy glow, but it's going to double my chances of getting melanoma.
Sunscreen.
Yes, I agree. It's a huge pain in the ass, but so worth it. Please.
Your skin's like an elephant. It never forgets.
Dear 16-year-old me, helping spread this message is how you'll honor Glenna's memory. At 16, she's already an incredible lifeguard. She loves the sun and the beach and tanning, but she just doesn't know.
She'll be diagnosed when she's 22 and will lose her battle when she's just 26.
I want you to know, because it's melanoma that's going to take the strongest man you know, your best friend, and the love of your life.
Dear 16-year-old me.
Don't be afraid. This isn't about being afraid.
I want you to be aware that melanoma is a young person's disease.
It is the second most common cancer in children and teenagers, and one of the most common in young adults.
And it can be deadly.
I want you to know you're not helpless.
This is a cancer that shows itself
right there on the outside of you.
Start checking your skin.
Please check. Get to know your skin.
Get to know your skin.
Start checking your skin.
If a new mole shows up, or if one you have starts to change color, or size, or shape, or feels different.
If something seems out of place, get your doctor to have a look as soon as possible.
Know what to look for and get help. These are all signs your skin could be developing cancer.
You brush your teeth every day, maybe even floss.
Okay, we both know you don't floss.
But just once a month, I want you to check.
It takes 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
Dear 16-year-old me, I do realize you're not actually going to see this, but someone else will, and it'll make a difference to them.
Dear someone else.
Dear somebody else.
If you're watching this,
send it to a 16-year-old you care about.
Send it to anyone who is once 16.
Or soon will be 16.
Send this.
and check yourself. Educate yourself. You can download tools and information about melanoma here.
Share this link. Tweet this link.
Post this to your Facebook.
Dear 16-year-old me, think about some of the things that we can do to reduce our risk of all skin cancers. Avoiding sun exposure when that ultraviolet radiation is at its peak. That's during the main part of the day, but it's worth that. Seek shade or make your own if you are out there. Wear a wide-brimmed hat. You know, get under some trees, get under a shade structure. Cover up, you know, if our skin is not exposed, we won't have that much exposure by that ultraviolet radiation. Avoid tanning beds and use some broad spectrum sunscreen. Use it in sufficient quantity and repeat that application every 2 or 3 hours. Sunscreen is not something we can rely on by itself, or we can do once in the morning and then we're good for the day. It really does mean a constant reminder, a constant reapplication. So that's obviously the one I want to end on, because that is of greatest significance to you as a young adult. So do think about your behaviors now. Try to reduce your risk of not only this cancer, but many of the others. We've talked a lot about cardiovascular system today, risk factors for cardiovascular disease. We've talked about cancer, some of the common cancers, their risk factors, what we can do to minimize those. So I really do hope that you take all of these things that you've read in the text, you are sharing in your comments, that you are hearing from me, and that you are hearing from the video clips, and think about how you can lower your personal risk for heart disease and cancer. Think about what you've learned. Share it with somebody that you love. In sharing, not only do we learn it better, but we share that information to maybe help protect someone we care about. All right, so I've got a couple more comments. I want to get these in quickly before my end of broadcast reminders. Jocelyn, glad you are here today. Key information that I learned is the process of how blood gets pumped by the heart and those risk factors for cardiovascular disease. So looking at reducing risk of heart cancer, of heart disease and cancer, by exercising and eating healthy foods. Good job. Thank you so much. Melanie is here. Glad you are here. I learned how to reduce heart disease and cancer. An interesting fact I found is that men are more likely to die from heart disease and stroke and hypertension than women. But that doesn't put us in the clear, does it? And then to reduce the risk of cancer and heart disease, being active. A few minutes of physical activity during the week can lower our risk for heart disease. And I'm going to suggest a few minutes every single day. And then watching weight. That is certainly a factor for both heart disease and cancer. All right. Thank you much for sharing your comments today on the broadcast. I know we covered a lot of information very quickly. I do encourage you to read before you watch the broadcast. I think it will make a lot more sense when you do that. But if you didn't get a chance, hang on, read, come back and watch the broadcast again so it makes a little bit more sense. A couple of reminders for you this week. You have a quiz that will open up in about a half an hour at 5 o'clock. That quiz will be open for you to take until next Tuesday. That's March 21st, 11:59 p.m. Do not wait until the last few minutes to take that quiz. If you have problems, if you get your quiz in late, you will not be able to retake that. The other reminder I have for you is that your second journal entry is also due next Tuesday by 11:59. Keep in mind, you need to read the instructions very carefully. You are going to submit a response that is at least 4 paragraphs long. I am looking for well-developed paragraphs, 3 to 6 sentences at least in each of those. Your first paragraph is just giving me a quick update. How are you doing with that health behavior that you identified in your first journal that you wanted to work on? Second paragraph, how are you analyzing the internal and external influences on your behavior? And what kind of coping strategies are you using to deal with those influences? The third paragraph is, tell me about your efforts to communicate with your family and friends what you are trying to do. When they ask if you want to go out and do this or that, and you say, no, I'm trying to be healthy. How are you communicating with them? How is that going? And then the final paragraph, tell me what you are specifically doing to stay on track with your new behavior. How are you meeting your goals to get to that end result? So this is kind of your mid-semester check-in with me. I just want to know how you're doing, and maybe in writing this, you might think, oh my gosh, I've completely forgotten about it, and that will get you back on track. So again, quiz and journal due next week. And before next Wednesday, read chapter 16, because next week's broadcast will be about personal safety. So with that, I want to wish each and every one of you health, peace, and happiness. Have a great week.